PhD students in Pakistani universities can go to other universities elsewhere in the world, sort of top 200 universities.
Yeah, top 200.
Supported by the government to do an aspect or a facet of their research, not just in the U.S., but other universities around the world as well. And so Rafiq has been here for 6 months, and so he'll describe for you, he's just about to go, actually he's about to leave this week. He will describe his overall research and a little bit of background about Pakistan, and as well as the part that he's been doing at Iowa State.
So, I'm Muhammad Rafiq.
I'm a visiting scholar here in Mark Gleason's lab from last 6 months. So, this is a program funded by our government, as just Mark Gleason for that. So here is the topic of my research, management of black scurf of potato by commercial biofertilizers and asteraceous weeds. So here is the outline about my presentation. So first I am going to introduce Pakistan, something about Pakistan, and then my research work, my objective, the results, and at the end I am going to present my summary. So here is the map, and here is Pakistan, which is located in South Asia, and they also have brought crossroads to Middle Asia and Central Asia. That's why it has a very good strategic importance for the whole world. That's why it always remains in the news. So Pakistan, you can see in the map itself, we have four neighbor countries, Afghanistan, Iran, India, and China. And 2/3 of the population is our neighbors. So I am studying in University of the Punjab, Lahore. That is located in Lahore, Punjab, Lahore, as you can see in the map itself. So this is the first province of Punjab, Pakistan, Punjab, which means the land of five rivers, having five rivers in the state itself. So this is the big province according to the population of Pakistan, which is also known as the breadbasket of the country, because this is the agricultural state of the country, producing most of the raw material for the industry and also the food for the peoples. So all these five rivers are coming from the Himalayas itself and running throughout the country. So this is mostly agricultural state, producing cotton, wheat, sugarcane, and all other stuff. So if we talk about the culture and heritage of Punjab, it is very rich in culture and heritage. So this is the picture first I showed there, is the picture of monument, which is known as Minare Pakistan. This is the place where people gathered in 1940 to decide, and where they passed a resolution to decide that they are going to get a new country from British. We are British colony before that, and India was united. After that, India was divided into two countries, Pakistan and India. So here is the place where they passed a resolution about Pakistan. And this is the shrine of Shah Rukh Ne Alam, a big saint from my area, my hometown itself. So he was a big saint of his time, who migrated from Arab to Pakistan in India at that time, and started preaching about Islam in the region. So this is Sindh, the second province of Pakistan, which is very civilized, having old, much older civilization of the world, and that is Mohenjo-daro, which was discovered just few years back, and you can see it was 2500 BC before that. So this was discovered few years before that, and when they dig the soil from the upper layer, they found very plant towns behind the scene, in the surface of the soil. So this is the oldest civilization on the earth itself. And this is Ranikot Fort, We have a big fort in Pakistan, and they are the remainings of the kingship, kings and other, just like occupants. Everyone who ruled us just made such type of big forts for themselves to protect their empire from the attacks from the other empire. So these forts basically protected their empires. So now they are the cultural and heritage sites. So this is Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, which has the road access to Afghanistan itself. This is very important, Khyber Pass, the place from which you can enter into Afghanistan. This is called Khyber, Babi Khyber or Khyber Pass. From here you can get entry into Afghanistan, and this is the place up to which extent British never passed that place, because once British tried to invade into Afghanistan and they were defeated very badly, and British decided to go back to India, and they never conquered Afghanistan, and that's why Afghanistan is known as the graveyard of the empires. No one can occupy that country itself. So this is the Kalam Valley, very good tourist spot for the tourist. Many international tourists also like to visit this place. This is very beautiful place for the tourists if someone is interested to visit. So this is the Balochistan, our last province, which is the biggest according to area, but very less population. This province contains most of the mountains and very good natural resources. World third largest gas reservoir is also here. And this is the Gwadar port, which is newly constructed. And this is very deep sea port in the South Asia. And before that, it was Dubai's port, which was deep sea, but this is more deeper than that port itself. And China is trying to use for this port for the trade with the world. And this is Baloch culture. I am also a Baloch, and this is our culture. So these are our main major crops which we produce in Pakistan. Cotton, which provides the raw material for the textile industry, and our textile industry shares have a good share in the GDP, and also provide employment to a big community. And wheat, rice, maize, and sugar cane. We are producing world best rice in the Pakistan. There is a region in Pakistan, Sheikhupura region, which produce basmati rice. Some of you might know about that varieties. Basmati rice is world famous rice due to its fragrance. When you cook it, it has a specific fragrance that come out of it. That's why it is highly demanding in the world, and we are exporting this rice. So sugar cane, if we talk about sugar cane, we are also producing a good quantity of sugar cane for the sugar industry, and we are also exporting sugar to the world. Mountain in the world. This is also in Pakistan, and many tourists come to just conquer this mountain. And this is the plains of Punjab where rice is being planted. I just showed for the audience. And this is the desert jeep rally. We started just 5-10 years before, and this jeep rally is organized by the government, and many international people are also coming there to take participate in this rally. And this is very good jeep rally. If you guys are interested in this, this would be an adventure for you. And this is University of the Punjab, Lahore, we are studying. This was also established by the British in 90s. When they were there, they also made one university for us. So this is the new campus of the University, Institute of Agricultural Sciences. This has four departments: entomology, horticulture, food technology, and plant pathology. I myself from plant pathology department. So this is my disease on which I am working, black scurf of potato, caused by rhizoctonia. So now here you can see the symptoms on the tuber. These are symptoms on the tuber, and these are the symptoms on the plant. You can see the sclerotia on the surface of the tubers, and here are the brown sunken lesions on the underground stem and the stolon. These are the typical symptoms of the disease. So potato is being cultivated in Punjab, which is the breadbasket of the country. We have good area for the its cultivation, and 4 million tons we are producing, and it's very cheap staple food of the country. we have normally in every dish, potato curry is there for the homemade side. So this is the pathogen, which is causing black scurf of potato, as a cholesterol and life. And these are mycelia, and one thing, one prominent feature of this fungus is that it's mycelia, when they get confused, used with each other, they see an angle of 90. So, here's my objective. My objective, of course, is management of black scurf of potato with biofertilizers and extracts of Asteraceous weeds. So, plan of work, I'm going to present my plan of work. So first I have to screen out different weed extract which are effective against the economically important disease, black scurf of potato. So second step is identification of antifungal compound from those extracts. And the third step is best combination of weed and biofertilizers to manage the disease in an eco-friendly way, not using any chemical. So these are the weeds from the Asteraceae family which I used for my research work. And the first one is Sumcus arvensis, Lentium stumerium, Carthamus arvigantha, and the last one is Libium marianum. I screened these four weeds for their antifungal potential in the lab first, and then decided to take them to the field because they were effective in the field. First I screened them for their antifungal potential. So how I extracted, evaluated my extracts. What was the step involved in extract evaluation? First, I collected the weeds from the barren lands near the university and near the roads. I collected those weeds from those areas, and these weeds don't have any use. I collected them from the barren lands itself. They don't have any use. But these weeds have very good antifungal compounds. After my research, I came to that point. So, second step was after the weed collection, I dipped them in the methanol and prepared their extracts to check their efficacy against our pathogen. So the third step was lab bioassays. So after preparation of extract, I decided to conduct the lab bioassays. For that, I tested these extract in test tubes itself. So this is last step was data collection and statistical analysis. So this is the picture tutorial presentation of one of my reads. Lentium stumerium, whose results were very good against the pathogen. Here you can see this is control. Yeah. The control is on the top and leaf. You can see no growth in the leaf and in the stem. The concentration is going to decrease from right to the left. So you can see zero growth in the right side, and as the concentration of the extract is going to reduce, the growth of the pathogen is going to increase up to some extent. But this is the weed which showed very good and prominent results against the pathogen. So here is the graphical presentation. The big bar is presenting the growth of the pathogen, and the small bars are presenting the growth of the pathogen when we added the extracts in the test tubes. So there is a prominent difference, you can see the effect of the extracts if we add in the test tubes in the lab bioassays. So here is the work which I done at ISU. So I worked after lab bioassays. I worked here for the detection of antifungal compounds from the Asteraceous weeds. And I went to molecular biology building because they have the GCMS facility. So we can do that there. So antifungal compound identification. So how I did, I went to methodology first, then I will show my results. So first step is sample dilution. You have samples, you have voltage set, and you have diluted just to prepare your samples for the GCMS analysis. And the second step is overnight drying. You have to dry your samples for the overnight so that water and if any unrelated thing is there, that can be evaporated. You have to dry for the overnight. The third step is methoxymation. You have to add methoxybride in the peri-peri dye to make it good for the next step. And volatile compounds are also evaporated at this step, and you have to shake it at 30 degrees centigrade heated at 30 degrees centigrade for the continuous shaking. So the next step is TMS, trimethylsilylation. So in this step, you add trimethylsilate and you heat the sample at 60 degrees centigrade for the 60 minutes. So the last step is GC UMS. And the last step, we just run our samples in the GC machine, and the machine gives us the results. And this is the spectra. It shows a time bar against the abundance of the compounds. You can see the time bar. The compounds with the less hydrocarbon just been detected in the start. It means they have very less number of carbons. These are volatile compounds which have been detected in the start. As the time increases, most of the some of the compounds are also detected in the headline. It means these compounds have much of the hydrocarbon, and that's why they require high temperature to be detected in the GC machine. At the end, because the GC works at the temperature starting from 70 and goes up to 270, the compounds which are most volatile, they are detected in the start, and compounds which are, they are less volatile, and they are start at the end when temperature goes to 270. So here the spectra of one of my weed which I showed here. So these are some compounds which I detected. They are the big list of compounds which I detected from my GCMS analysis. I'm unable to show all of the compounds here. I just try to show some of the compounds which I detected over there. So here is a list of 8-10 compounds which I detected here. The molecular formula, molecular weight, retention index, and retention time, etc. So the last step is evaluation of weed biomass and biofertilizer, which was my main objective also. For this, I did a greenhouse experiment in Pakistan, whose data still I have to evaluate. So these weeds were also effective in the greenhouse when I tested them in the greenhouse. So for this step, first I have to prepare for myself for the greenhouse. I bought parts and sterilized soils and inoculated those put that soil in the parts, and then I artificially inoculated all of the parts with the pathogen. And the next step is potato sowing. Before potato sowing, I also added biofertilizers in the soil, because there is companies which are making biofertilizer, they are claiming that these biofertilizers are effective against the disease management. You can use them in the field to manage your disease, and they also increase the plant health. That's why I also added. So I gave 1 week time to the pathogen to get established in the soil, and I also gave 1 week to the biofertilizer to get established in some bacteria. So after potato sowing, after 2 months of potato sowing, I took leaf of plants and did their physiological assay. These assays include PPO, polyphenol oxide, and PAL, polyphenol anhydrase, and protein. And I also observed the disease intensity, which includes disease incidence and severity. Disease incidence mean how much tuber they got and how much are infected and how much are the healthy. Severity mean how much is the disease intensity on the single tuber itself, not on the whole. So incidence include all the tubers, and severity include only single tuber. So I also recorded yield from each part, how much is the yield and how this pathogen is affecting on the yield of the. So statistical analysis are still going ongoing, but one thing I got from the field is that these weeds are effective in the field also. So here is a summary of my work, which I did in Pakistan and also here. Asteraceous weeds contain antifungal compounds, and these antifungal compounds hold the potential to control the pathogen, which is resistant.
That's all. Thank you. Questions? Or I think we have plenty of time.
Yes.
So, were you expecting a particular antifungal compound? from your samples and then you find that compound.
Yeah, I have detected 460 compounds from single sample. So I have, that is a big list. I just showed here 5 or 7 samples. I am going to analyze all the data after going back from here because I am very short in time here. I don't have time to analyze all the data here. I already have detected all the compounds in my samples. So that's I will do in my thesis and you will further side papers also.
But you know, I think you were asking,
so what I'm asking
there particular
was,
compounds that are.
Did you have a particular one you were looking forward to finding?
No, I was not looking for a particular compound.
Okay, we just kind of
yeah,
doing
I was just looking for the antifungal potential of the weeds, either they have or not.
Okay.
I just trying to give up an alternate way of controlling the disease, not using chemicals all the time. So these, my main objective was to find out and the potential of the weeds, they are effective against the disease management or not. That's what I found.
Okay.
So I was not looking for a particular compound.
Okay.
Yes.
How did you identify the weeds that were worth screening, that you decided to screen?
First I tried to identify them from encyclopedia, some of the books. I just went to the Asteraceous family and selected the weeds and then identified with the help of my professor who is also a botanist.
Mm-hmm.
So after the identification, then I collected the weeds. First step was the identification of the weeds.
Did you know that those weeds were going to be antagonistic or were not going to be susceptible to rhizoctonia?
Yeah. In the start, I know nothing about that. They are antagonistic or not. That's why I went to the lab assay in the start. If they are going to show some activity, then I will go to the next step. If they are not going to show activity, then I will eliminate that weeds on that step itself. I'm not going to do the next experiment.
Are those weeds host for rhizoctonia or alternative host for rhizoctonia solanine? No. So rhizoctonia does not grow on those weeds?
Yeah, the rhizoctonia don't grow on
those
weeds. Yes. That's I showed in the test tube assay also.
Okay.
You can see the difference in the control growth and in the growth of the pathogen we are added extremes.
So for the antifungal compounds, what's your next step? What do you plan to do with them? There are so many.
Yeah, I next step, I have to isolate all these compounds from extracts to HPLC and have to identify which compound is basically responsible for the suppression of the pathogen growth. So I have to do one assay still, which assay will detect which compound is most effective against the specific pathogen. Now I added the whole extract. I don't know which effective compound was there who reduced the growth of the pathogen. But in the next step, I am going to identify that compound. Now I have identified the compound which are present in my extract. But I don't know which compound is basically responsible for the reduction of the growth of the pathogen. Next step, I have to do that.
Yeah, I'm wondering because there are so many compounds. I'm wondering whether they're uniform for each of the species or whether they have a target, like some of the population in the pathogen may be more sensitive to some of the compounds.
First, I will try to isolate the major compounds, which are major in my extent. I also have their abundance that this compound is to my, how many percent of this compound contained your extract, I mean 20%, 10%. First, I will try to isolate the major compounds. We'll check their bioassay. If those compounds are responsible for the reduction of the growth of the pathogen, then I will focus on those compounds. If any minor compound is there who is reducing the growth of the pathogen, then I can go for that also.
Are you looking for any particular mode of action, like directly antifungal or reducing plant defense responses, or it doesn't matter?
I think I already stylized soil and everything was there. I'm not looking for that specifically.
Go back a slide or two, but I think this relates to
I noticed
Steve's
one
question.
Of your compounds that you picked to put on the slide
okay,
is
right
azelaic
there.
Acid.
No, this is just a list of compounds which I found from my samples, I told you.
Yeah, but I think.
Wait. Go forwards. Sorry, forwards. No. Other forwards.
Yeah,
this one here.
Yes.
Yeah, like the bottom one, azelaic acid.
Yes.
That is a compound that will induce plant defenses.
But yes, it might involve in plant inducing the resistance. But I don't know if it induced the plant resistance.
You didn't pick it and put it on here.
Yeah, I didn't pick it. This is I told you just the list which I got from after the analysis of my compounds. Okay. These compounds are present in my samples. So I right now I don't know which compound played the role in the suppression of the plant pathogen growth. But after that I have to go for the next step also. I will try to find out which specific compound is basically responsible for the reduction of the growth. I have to look for that.
So, you extract or found these compounds from pot study, lab study.
Yep.
Do you have any plan to extract such compounds from your field experiments that you are planning to conduct?
No, in the field you are not going to add extracts because farmer is not going to add extract.
No, my question is, do you have any plan to this kind of extractive study, but to find out what kind of compound that you're using in the field, you are applying these feed extracts in the field? Like these are from lab.
I'm not getting your point. Can you repeat your question?
Yeah, sure. My question is like, the samples you use for this, for these extracts,
yes,
they are from the lab study.
Yeah.
But do you have any plan to do the same study for the field?
I already have done in greenhouse, I told.
And did you find, like, is there any similarity in these?
Yes. No, I applied the whole weed in the field trials.
No, I didn't. Did you, like, try to extract from those samples as well? Like, which are active in, which are producing in pots or?
No, how can I extract from those samples? There was a tuber. I added the whole weed in my sample, in my field cell. Added the whole weed, which was just like dry biomass. I added the dry biomass in the soil. How can I get them back?
Would be a different experiment than
yeah,
we did.
That's how it is.
Yeah. Okay. That's, I think, I can't get from them, those samples. I can go for some other test, but that's not possible to get them back.
The question about, so, can you imagine, like, if your compounds look like they're pretty good against rhizoctonia, some of them,
yes,
could you imagine how a farmer would use that information? Could they grow a field of weeds and then till the weeds in, or how would they get those active compounds into the soil?
These weeds are very common in Pakistan. They are available everywhere. I am not saying that this can you apply on a large scale, but on small scale for the organic farming, this is very good option. Just go near the roadside. A lot of weed is there, just collect it and put it in your side.
Maybe put them in the row or something and till that in?
Yes. On barren lands, they are available. Just put them. It will take very less time. Dry them and add them in your soil. You can just manage your disease. Mm-hmm. You don't need to apply any chemical. This would be an alternate.
Further questions for Rafiq? Thank you.